This coverage is brought to you by Sherwood Engines, Amigos Tequila Beer, Jordan Road Servicing, Swift Leisure Group, Robinson Road Planing, Rally and Competition Equipment, Skipton Ford, and rallyprep.co.uk. Welcome to our coverage of the Trackrod Historic Rally, the final round of the 2013 West Wales Rally Spares RAC Championship. This has been one of the most eagerly awaited championships for many years, and one that really lived up to the hype. So we came to the start of the Trackrod Historic Rally, and this was really quite nice, being held in the centre of Pickering on an extremely pleasant early autumn evening, with a great turnout of spectators keen to see the historic cars, as well of course as the British Rally Championship cars competing on the concurrently running Rally Yorkshire. After the Series 1 and 1600cc cars had led the field away, it was unregistered local hero Steve Bannister who was the first of the rest of the field. His escort having a theoretical bullseye on the back of the car, which was surely going to get smaller and smaller as the rally got underway and Bannister disappeared from sight. And Welsh Rally boys Thomas Davies and Matt Edwards were just hoping to keep Bannister in sight over the first couple of stages. Although a returning Richard Hill would be hoping to put his car in amongst them at least. The Trackrod Rally is an unusual event in that it starts in daylight but then waits for it to go dark before venturing into the forests where two stages would await the crews, these being Staindale and Dalby. And this gave us a chance to catch up with a few of the competitors before they had even drawn sweat and get their views on the night ahead.
Nice to see you out again. You had problems on the red kite. Presumably they're all sorted out.
Yeah, they are. Yeah, I managed to sort that out. Just a minor problem, really. Just a clutch cylinder popped out, but one of those things. Really, never touched it on the car, and you know, me being a modern car driver, I'm not used to checking these things. So yeah, we've hopefully sorted that, and looking forward to a good run today now.
Yeah, what do you think? Do you go out at night very often yourself?
No, I don't really, to be honest. I do go well in the dark generally, so hopefully that's a good thing. And relying on some rather younger eyesight than a couple of the other front runners, but no, it's looking forward to it. I'm trying to beat the Dolby Demons tonight, I think. So.
And is this a rally in itself or a prelude to the RAC rally?
This is a rally in itself for me. I think we're a bit short on budget this year to do RAC again. They had a bit of a disaster last year, which has obviously hit funds for this year as well. So unfortunately, it doesn't look like we'll be doing the RAC at this moment in time. So.
Well, I've come out tonight because I'm hoping to do the Roger Albert Clark in a couple of months. So thought this would be quite good practice because we were using the same stages and I've missed all you guys. So I thought I'd come back.
But this is going to be a dry and dusty rally. Roger Albert Clark's completely different conditions.
Yeah, but obviously the same stages, and so yeah, it should be good fun.
And have you been out at all? Have you been rallying, or have you just been saving your money?
No, I've done a few events, but mainly tarmac, and obviously just wanted to get back and do a few more gravel events then before the RAC.
Just a bit of a warm up before the McRae next weekend, and well, it's always nice to come out and do different events.
Fairly local to you, isn't it?
Yeah, fairly local. Though I haven't been here that much in recent years. I think the last time I did track rod was in 2002, so it's been a long while.
Blimey. It was that long.
Yeah, it's been that long, and so like I say, we don't really use these North Yorkshire stages that much for anything else now. Now the Humberside doesn't run anymore and things like that, you don't get to come up here that much.
And what about it being in the dark? Is that an extra bonus, extra pleasure, or?
Well, I used to go all right in the dark, but I think old age is setting in now and I don't go so well. Or it's like a practice in the dark nowadays. We used to do loads of road rallies, so that used to help. And now I haven't done many of them for a while, so again, you get out of practice, don't you?
Nice to see you out on this event. You've had an enjoyable season. You must have enjoyed the competition.
Yeah, it's been a fantastic season. There's been some really good rallies, some good stages, and some very, very good competition. There's a lot of young lads coming on in escorts, very, very fast, putting some fantastic times up, and it's really good to see.
Now, I was going through some of my old videos a few months ago and saw you, I think, in the same car. It's been like 95 or 96. Is it the same car? And if so, how long you had it for?
No, it isn't the same car. I built this 3 years since,
okay,
from an old Shell that I had.
Right.
But yes, it brings back memories from my old BDAs that I had. And yeah. I think these are better.
Yeah.
And they're fun to drive. And I'm really, really enjoying my escort years again.
And the competition's fantastic. You don't run right at the front, but you're in that great pack, don't you, that's very, very close.
That's right. There's quite a few of us. It's all very similar, and it's very, very good competition. Yeah. And I'm thoroughly enjoying it.
And does it matter to you whether you finish at the front or the back of that group, or you just...
Well, obviously, I'd like to finish as high up as I can. I've still got the competition instinct,
yes.
But I have my car to mend myself, and I want to get home on a weekend, so there is a bit more caution than there used to be when I was younger, but I'm still enjoying it very, very much.
Nice to see you out again. You come out in this car infrequently, but when you go out, you go really well in it. What's the secret?
Well, we're still struggling with it, David, to be honest. Since the Ascona days, we've been altering things, which have altered again, and that's why we don't come out that often, because we just need a bit more time to get it settled.
Is it really difficult to get spares for these cars? Is this one of the problems you don't see too many of them?
The engine is the biggest problem because the cylinder block, the cylinder head is 30 years old, but the rest of the stuff we can get hold of. Most of the running gear is Ford Escort, you know, the ZF box, Atlas axle, the brakes. But it's just getting the setup right. I can't get anybody to help me to set it up properly.
Yes. Whereas you can, with an escort, it's 1,000 people who've got advice.
Well, that's right, or you can buy it off the shelf and it's already available, so, but no, and it's a different car as well, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, Rob Smith enjoys his, but he seems happier in his escort straight away.
Well, that's right, but again, I gather Rob's coming out on the Roger Albert, so that'll be good fun.
Yes.
See how we compare with Rob. I'm sure, hopefully, when we're around here, we're somewhere near him, but we'll see.
Tell me about your plans for this evening.
A marked improvement on the last time I was here for the Roger Albert Clark, which we managed to get three quarters of the way through the Dolby stage and hit a massive jump that I didn't see and knocked the cam belt off. So although we managed to continue on the next morning, but yeah, that is just the plan. So yeah, we're setting our target low and then we won't be disappointed.
And you've not been out so much this year, you've been busy with this car, I guess.
Yeah, we've done four or five rallies, probably done two or three of the RAC Championship and a couple of BTRDA rounds, but yeah, basically last few months concentrating on getting the Mark 1 finish for Africa. But that's all gone now, and on the high seas somewhere in the Mediterranean, and so we're having one last run out before we fly down to Mombasa in November.
So Ben's just about ready to go out on the first stage of the evening. He's had some great performances recently, but what's the secret of success?
I think he's just driving very well at the moment. The car's set up nicely for him, he's happy with it. I was watching some in-car video and he's really trusting the turning, and quite smooth straight lines, which seems to be working.
And are you instructing him in any way? Are you giving him driving advice?
No, I think, to be honest, it's obviously advice, yeah, but he's got his own style, and I don't want to say too much to him. He's going very well without my input.
Do you think that, you know, there's quite a few good sons, like Ben Llewellyn, David Llewellyn's son's going well as well. It's nice to see, you know, you're both former champions. Is it a hereditary thing, or is it learned knowledge? Is it knowledge you can pass on down to your son that helps?
I think it's in the genes. You know, his mother's a very fast driver.
Oh, really?
And that's I think that's where he gets
it
from. Yes, it is actually. But I think that must be where he gets it from. But no, I think he's been interested from a young age. Mm. He's seen the rally cars and we've talked about it, and he's looked at videos and stuff I've done, and I think gets a reasonable picture. But yes, obviously, it's obviously something.
You are fiercely competitive. Have you seen the same?
Yeah, yeah. He is, to be fair.
So we'll see if this is on 18. Yes, it is.
And the dark of the night was proving just as confusing for the competitors as it was for stateside commentator Bob Malloy, who was struggling to recognise the cars in the dark.
Don't forget, this is all off the map. They don't use notes. They can't they can make their own notes, but they can't recce it. So they come all the way around the outside the woodyard. I think 115, beg your pardon. So that's actually Richard Hill and Pat Cooper. Apologies for the confusion of numbers, but we're only going off our list rather than the start list. Interesting approach to the...
But anyway, after two stages in the dark in the Yorkshire forests, we all expected to see Steve Bannister and Louise Sutherland with something like a 30-second lead. But a look at the leaderboard after those stages caused people to spit out their beer in astonishment and check their times, because although there was a crew with a 30-second lead, it wasn't Bannister and Sutherland, but Edwards and Elliot Edmondson. And that was a massive shock to everybody, and not least to Edwards and Edmondson themselves. The West Wales Rally Spares RAC Championship now just had three daylight stages to run, and the season would be over. As ever on RAC events, the 1600cc cars were running at the front of the field, along with the Series 1 cars. And after a ridiculously fast run on the two night stages, where they had been 12th and 13th fastest, a slower time for Vince Bristow and Tim Sayer dropped them down the field a bit. But after Cropton, they were still lying in 17th place. Leading Series 1 at this point were John Everard and Mark Sharpley, who surely, as much as anybody, deserve a series win this season. And at least they were on target for the win here. With Stephen Higgins and Richard Simpson hanging on to second place behind them, despite their Saab 96 sounding like a cat being strangled at times. This car apparently only has about 80 to 90 horsepower, and according to Higgins, it is all at the top end. Although the top end of 90 horsepower isn't really very high, is it? Then came the Series 2 and 3 crews, and with the honour of being first on the road were Matt Edwards and Elliot Edmondson. But with that honour came the extra pressure of trying to hold off Steve Bannister on his home soil. And this spin didn't help much either. In all, Edwards lost about 13 seconds on the one stage, and his lead was almost halved. With two stages still to go, Bannister was hunting him down. So no pressure there then. It goes without saying that Bannister was quickest on the stage. Well, it just does, doesn't it? But it wasn't that far ahead of Richard Hill and Pat Cooper, who were simply flying here, and they were the fastest of the registered crews with some fabulous driving. Running in fourth overall now, but third of the registered runners, were Thomas and Ulrich Davis, but they didn't have a perfect start to the day, being only eighth fastest on Cropton. Tim Pearcey and Neil Shanks next along and moving up the field into fifth after they were only eighth fastest on the rally's first stage. And they were just 6/10 of a second behind Davis and Davis. Much is made of the fact that this is Steve Bannister's home territory, not least by me, but it's pretty much Warren Phillips-Kirk's home ground as well, and it showed with Phillips-Kirk and Nigel Hutchinson taking fourth fastest on the stage here and moving up to sixth. Once again, Ben Mellors and Alex Lee had set some stupidly fast times in their D3 Pinto engine car. They had been 7th and 8th fastest on the first night stages to lie in 8th overall, and they hung on to that position after Cropton. James Potter and Bob Duck were next, these two involved in a close battle with the unregistered Nick Cook, and looking quick and enjoying themselves at the same time. Two one-off cars came along after them, with Tim Mason throwing his Porsche 911 through the stages and just hanging around the top 10. And Steve Perez driving the Lancia Stratos as quick as he dared. This car most certainly doesn't seem to be the easiest car in the world to drive, but nobody cares. Everybody just loves it. And in the Porsche, navigator Graham Wild was in something like his fourth different car in 6 weeks, with several different drivers, and with more variation to come before the season is over. Interestingly, Perez had John Millington alongside him on this event, so I think we can work out where Millington's maps will be on this November's RAC Rally. And then came the Squires brothers, this ultra-reliable crew in their ultra-reliable car going just as well as ever. Can anyone remember when the last time was that this duo retired from a rally in this car? And just behind them were the Bentley boys, Mark and Ed. And although these two don't have quite so much luck on these shorter events, their heads have been turned now by the Safari Rally. Tim Freeman's rally wasn't going to plan though, and as can be clearly seen, the car was running really low at the back, and he and Ashley Trimble soon retired, not surprisingly, with rear suspension failure. Running in the FIA series on this event, Peter Egerton and Alan Cook were not only having fun, but holding on to the lead there. However, the lead was only 1.8 seconds over Tom Coftrey and Calvin Coolidge, who were just behind them, and they were taking it in turns to set the fastest series times. In Series 2, although Richard Hill was well down the road and Tim Mason not too far behind him, there was a fabulous battle between Terry Cree, Chris Brown, Vince Bristow and David Kirby in their mishmash of Class C2, C3 and C5 cars. At the end of Cropton, it was Cree who held the lead in this battle, but the four cars were only covered by 0.9 of a second after almost 30 minutes of rallying. But coming up like a train behind them were Barry Jordan and James Grattan Smith. And a top 10 overall time on Cropton did them a world of good, and they picked up four places on this one stage alone. It was fantastic to see the Trackrod Historic Rally as part of the 2013 West Wales Rally Spares RAC Championship. And with the recent announcement of the 2014 calendar, fantastic to see that it could be here to stay. The schedule mirrors the 2013 calendar, but with the addition of the Seven Valley Stages, one of the classic Welsh gravel events. The prime motivation when compiling the calendar was to give competitors the chance to compete over the best quality gravel roads available. In addition, the schedule reflects a wish from many competitors for one-day gravel rallies run on Saturdays. The 2014 schedule starts on Sunday the 2nd of February, with the Red Kite Stages at Llandovery. Sunday 2nd of March sees the Mid Wales Stages in Newtown. Saturday 26th of April sees the Tour of Hamsterley in Shildon. Saturday 31st of May brings us the Seven Valley Stages in Bilth Wells. Saturday 21st of June sees the Carlisle Stages in Carlisle. Saturday 9th of August brings us the Neath Valley Stages in Resolven. And Saturday the 27th of September brings us the final round, the Trackrod Historic Cup, based in Pickering. This superb schedule of events reflects the views and wishes of the competitors. The route for the Tour of Hamsterley, for example, will have a significantly different look for 2014, and the championship team is very grateful to all the event organisers for their hard work in 2013. The 2014 schedule will take RAC contenders into some of the best forest stages available, including classics like Crooken, Pikes Peak, Haffron, Kershaw, Riola, Margam, Dalby and Cropton. On to stage 4, Gale Rigg. And although John Everard and Mark Sharpley were starting to pull away from Stephen Higgins and Richard Simpson in Series 1, there was little doubt that Higgins was driving the Saab just as quickly as it would go. And we asked him how his rally was going.
It's going all right now. Bad start, very bad start. First stage, pulled off the start line and went into second and we lost everything. No gears at all. So we were stuck for about 2 minutes. And we managed to get third gear. So we went through the stage in third gear, got to the end, and miraculously all the gears had come back again. So second stage was brilliant and today's been excellent.
At the front of the field, the pace was still phenomenal, with Edwards absolutely on the limit, and to his great relief, able to keep the deficit to Bannister to only 4 seconds on this stage. This meant that he would go into the final stage, Langdale, with a 13-second lead, and we chatted to him about his extraordinary rally so far.
Well, the obvious question is, what happened to you last night?
I don't know, I don't think I was driving the car.
Those times are ridiculous.
Yeah.
3.7 seconds on Steve Bannister. In the dark, in the Yorkshire Forest, do you think
Tell me.
I don't know. I think it just all went to plan. I think we had a bit of a game plan and obviously done a lot of work on the notes and things like that for the darkness. And I think it just all came together, really. Just stuck to the game plan. And, you know, just everything just came together for once. And I think I had my retribution on Dolby after the RAC. So
when you saw your time at the end of the first stage, you must have been fairly surprised. When you saw your time at one of the second stage, you must have been hardly able to.
Well, I think the trick was we didn't see the one for the first stage before we went into the second.
So all you saw was that you had a 30-second lead?
Yeah, that was the first thing
you
saw.
What did you think? What was your reaction?
I don't know, I just went a bit nuts, really. I didn't really know what was going on.
It's like it was just, all in one in golf for the first major or something.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. It never happens, does it?
No.
This sort of thing never happens up here. And to be able to pull that off was, I think, fairly special moment for me. And, you know, it's just... It's one of those moments that makes all the effort and the time that you put in worthwhile. Just for that one moment, you try and convince everybody that the time and effort is worthwhile, and it's those little moments that I think that do that.
And it's when you look at the timesheet and expect yourself to be third or fourth. Where am I? Oh my God, I'm in the lead.
We planned no more than 30 seconds behind him. So this morning we were a minute better off than we
hoped. There was more than a few people checking to see if you'd got a fire last night, including me. And
including us. Yeah, we checked the watch. Checked it 30 seconds. No, that's got to be a minute wrong.
All right, then tell me about today then, because obviously you're dropping time to Steve, but do you want to win the rally or just the RAC Championship event?
Had you asked me that yesterday, I'd have said I want to win the RAC bit, but now I don't think you're going to get many opportunities to pull off a banner victory in Yorkshire. So. We had a half spin this morning.
Okay.
So
that's why you dropped so much time on the first
one. We had a bit of a four-wheel drive in the head moment and went for the gas instead of letting it pull out slowly. But so he's taken 13, 17. Yeah. But that's not really based on pace, if you like. That's a mistake. So if we carry on at the same pace, it'll be close. But I don't know. I think I can dine out on last night for the rest of my rallying career, I think. So we've achieved enough. So, we'll just have a go and we'll see how we get on. Stick some knee boots on and see how we get on, I think. But, it's been a bit of a memorable weekend, I think.
On Gaelrig itself, the first three registered runners were separated by only 0.9 of a second, which just shows the competitiveness of this championship. And with Edwards quickest, it was Tim Pearcey and Neil Shanks who were second, and Richard Hill and Pat Cooper third quickest in their Mark 1 Escort. And we spoke to Hill at the service halt.
Really, really on the pace this morning. Are you sort of just trying to get to the end of the rally now, or are you just going as quick as you can and get a good result?
We're going well, and but doing nothing daft with it, and being careful in places. But getting a good pace ready for next weekend up on the Macrae.
I like the idea of you being careful at the speed you're going.
Yeah, I know it sounds. You just get into a good rhythm, don't you? And you've got to. Everything works right if you're going at the right sort of speeds.
If you take off a little bit, you don't really notice it in the times, and it feels a lot safer. I suppose that's what you're doing.
Yeah, well, whether you could go any faster if you tried or not, you might end up in the scenery. You don't know. It's you just do what you do, and famous last word saying driving within my means. But you just going at a good lick and very happy with the times to be as close as we are to Steve Bannister up here. You can't do any better than that, really.
No.
And we're in a Mark 1 as well, which doesn't go as well as a Mark 2, so yeah.
Just behind that group of three were Thomas and Ulrich Davis, with Thomas going as wide as he could into this bend just to try and enter the straight as quickly as possible. This was because he'd fitted a new diff before the event, which would have allowed him to reach a maximum speed of 142 miles an hour on the straights, if there was a straight long enough. I told him he should have entered a sprint at an airfield instead. Sadly, just about now, Ben Mellor's great rally, and indeed great season, came to a sudden and comprehensively abrupt end when he slid his Mark II Escort into a ditch and, in trying to get the car out of it, crashed into a hidden culvert instead, seriously damaging both his foot and his car. Fortunately, both are fixable, and I'm sure that we'll see him out again in 2014. And talking of 2014, the format for the 2014 RAC Championship has been confirmed, and will cover all regular historic classes as well as an open category for non-historic pre-87 cars. Once again, the core of the championship will be the existing historic categories 1, 2 and 3, covering cars produced up to the end of 1981. But new for 2014 will be the full introduction of category 4 for cars produced up until the end of 1985. In addition, a separate category K will be home to pre-86 cars complying to FIA Appendix K regulations. Running in parallel to the historic cars will be category O for all two-wheel drive open class cars, originally built before the end of 1986. On at least a few of the events, category O cars will run within the concurrent modern event. In summary, the categories are category 1, for cars built up to December 1967, prepared to MSA historic regulations. Category 2, for cars built up to December 1974, prepared to MSA historic regulations. Category 3 is for cars built up to December 1981 and prepared to MSA historic regulations. Category 4 is for cars built up to December 1985 and prepared to MSA historic regulations. While Category K is for cars built up to December 1985 but prepared to FIA Appendix K regulations. And finally, Category O is for two-wheel drive cars built up to December 1986. One of the founding principles of the RAC Championship is to focus on cars prepared to MSA and FIA historic regulations. In 2014, this will be developed to fully embrace the new Category 4 and also offer a place for open category cars to come out and compete. And as a backup to all this, we spoke to Championship Manager Colin Heppenstall.
The championship next year will be mainly aimed at historic competitors once again, with the MSA changing the Blue Book regulations, allowing Category 4 cars into the championship. So we're going to be 1, 2 and 3 as normal and the new Category 4. Really looking forward to it. What's the Category 4 going to bring? We're not quite sure at the moment. Hopefully it'll be the same as what happened with Category 3 when that first started. One or two cars to start off and then it'll build and build. Hopefully to what we've got with all the D5 Escorts now, will it be whatever with whatever cars it will be, who knows? But it's a great opportunity, and hopefully the competitors over the years will then come and join the championship with those cars. The competitors have been to us and said, can we look at changing the point system? We knew when we started in 2013 it was a complicated point system, and when we're actually been working them out, it's taken about 4 hours to do each round. It's been really, really complicated. So yes, the competitors have asked for us to simplify it, and yes, we're going to look at making it a lot more simpler. Some of the competitors have asked, can we look at amalgamating some of the classes that don't have a lot of competitors in, like B1, B2, B3, amalgamating it into one, so they can score more points. And if that's what the competitors are wanting, that's what the championship's all about, and it makes sense. We're always looking at technical championship regulations with John Cooper, the eligibility coordinator, with the eligibility team that we have working alongside the championship. We've taken a lot of considerations of various changes that competitors have brought to us during the year in 2013 to see what we can look at changing for 2014. And we're making some slight amendments to various regulations that the competitors have led themselves, and hopefully we'll bring a more level playing field for 2014 that everyone can compete into.
So here we are on the final stage of the 2013 West Wales Rally Spares RAC Championship, and the 15 miles of Langdale would be as good a test as anyone could face, and especially Matt Edwards, who would start the stage with a 13 second lead over Steve Bannister. And although this battle wouldn't affect the championship positions, as Bannister wasn't registered, you knew that both drivers desperately wanted to win the rally. But before we look at that battle, let's take a look at how the different classes worked out. And in Series 1, John Everard's Alpha's handling was giving him problems again. But no matter, he recovered quickly enough with help from the marshals, and he and Mark Sharpley would take the victory by a comfortable 6-minute margin. And as a bonus, they would also take the Series 1 Championship Award. And in second place were Stephen Higgins and Richard Simpson, the Saab driver happy in the knowledge that he couldn't really drive his car much quicker. In Class C2, Vince Bristow continued his comeback with another victory and took 14th overall, which is a fine result in a 1600cc car, in which he also finished second overall in Series 2 on the event. And David Kirby and Chris Rixon would take C3 on this event after another strong drive, which saw them finishing 7th overall in the championship and 2nd in Series 2. But for Terry Cree in his German BMW, sadly for him, the rally was over as he retired on the final stage, but he would still take the championship honours in Series 2. After Ben Mellor's demise, which fortunately for him didn't stop him taking the Class D3 championship honours, it was Paul Fry and Mike Steele who were class winners after what looked like a pretty impressive run. In C5, there was massive disappointment for Richard Hill and Pat Cooper when their Escort broke its gearbox on the final stage, and they were out. So all eyes were now on Barry Jordan's astonishing pace over the last few stages, in which he picked up place after place. And in the end, he and James Grattan-Smith would take that class with a stunning time on Langdale, despite nearly throwing it all away here. Which pushed Chris and Ali Brown down to second in class, but Chris was still grinning from ear to ear at the end of the event. And Nick Jarvis finished his consistent season, which saw him score points in every round, in third place, and with a fine 8th place overall in the championship. In the FIA series, the excellent battle between Tom Coftrey and Peter Edgerton would continue until the end, with Edgerton and co-driver Alan Cook claiming the victory on the final stage. Leaving Coftrey and co-driver Calvin Coolidge to take second and gain a good result after what has been a season of improvement for them. Tim Mason and Graham Wild had a great rally, finishing 6th overall of the registered runners, winning Class C4 and taking the Series 2 honours as well, which was a well-deserved reward just for looking so spectacular everywhere. Moving into D5 and the overall positions, Jerry Bailey and Graham Lacey would finish quite a way down the field, but it wasn't for the lack of trying. But Mark and Ed Bentley took 8th overall, in what was a great result for these seldom seen kids. Without doubt, one of the best performances on this final stage came from Phil and Mick Squires, who managed to pick up 8 places to drag themselves into 7th of the registered runners, and that's a great way for these staunch RAC Rally Championship supporters to finish their season. James Potter and Bob Duck finished their season with a bang as well. A great 5th place overall on the stage, moving them up to 5th in the final standings. and they were just behind Warren Phillips Cook and Nigel Hutchinson, who had another good event and with two fourth fastest times in the last three stages, would finish the rally in fourth place of the registered runners. So in third place were Thomas and Ulrich Davies, who found, not surprisingly, that being geared to do 142 miles an hour on these stages was no great advantage to them. And so they probably didn't have the sort of pace that they had hoped for on this particular rally. But at least the car was in one piece and ready to do the RAC. The runners-up of the RAC Championship competitors were Tim Pearcey and Neil Shanks, who flew through the day's three stages and took third fastest time on each one. And of course, they were third overall as well. And so we came to the battle for the overall lead of the event. And although Matt Edwards could have eased up with championship points at stake, he was having none of that and was determined to fend off everything that Bannister could throw at him, even if it did mean driving right on the ragged edge. And that, I think, it's fair to say, was close. Edwards kept his cool and at the end was relieved and delighted to discover that Bannister had only beaten him on this stage by 1 second and that victory was his by 11.9 seconds.
Well done, Steve. What a day. Yeah. Really enjoyed it. See you later.
Oh dear.
To use the old cliche, how does it feel?
I don't know, ask me tomorrow.
That's
I don't know, I thought about it last night and I said before, and if I managed to win an event this year, that would probably be my greatest achievement, and to have done that, I couldn't have done another 20 miles with that pressure on me.
Well, he's taken 1 second off you.
Yeah.
On 50 miles of Langdale.
Yeah.
Steve Bannister.
I don't know, just hooked it up, I guess. We had an absolute mother and father at the moment, to be fair.
Yeah.
on a five left, and we were in the grass that side, then that side, on that side, and we came out and we were still in fourth gear.
Let me ask you, how do you feel about that then?
Oh, brilliant. Yeah, no, loved it. Yeah, first time in Yorkshire, and come away with that, so can't ask for much more, really.
Well done, the pair of you.
And so this was the result of the 2013 Trackrod Historic Rally, a result which also gave Edwards the Class D5 Championship Award. With the championship positions looking like this, and showing a clear and dominant victory to Marty McCormack and Phil Clark. And there is only one thing that you can really say about them. By Sherwood Engines, Amigos Tequila Beer, Jordan Road Servicing, Swift Leisure Group, Robinson Road Planing, Rally and Competition Equipment, Skipton Ford, and rallyprep.co.uk.